RadioOrNot.com and SoFloRadio.com present The Nicole Sandler Show.
Truth to power, baby.
And now, here's Nicole.
Yes, we do. Good morning. Welcome to a brand new week. It is a Monday. I'm Nicole Sandler, coming to you live at RadioOrNot.com, TalkRadio1.com. I believe George Rodriguez is relaying our signal through at SoFloRadio.com. Still having problems with that streaming computer. We're working on it, though. All right, and once we have it up and fully functioning again, we'll be back on ProgressiveBlendRadio.com. This is what happens when you work on a shoestring budget. But we do our best here. Nicole Sandler here. And wow, a lot going on. First of all, if you tune in early for the pre-show music, yeah, you know, I got to get my disc jockey on somehow. And you know that was my background. So it was a set of music dedicated to Alan West. We heard the James Gang Walk Away. Marvin Gaye's Got to Give It Up. Yeah. Lily Allen, Fuck You, by request. We heard Amy Mann's That's Just What You Are. The Birds, I'll Feel a Whole Lot Better When You're Gone. And Ben Folds 5, Song for the Dumped. Yeah. You know, here's the deal with Alan West. I had actually supported his push for a recount because here's the deal. This is Florida. We do not know how to count votes. Actually, everything they do here in Florida is pretty backwards. And so what happened is over the course of the weekend, Alan West actually went to court for a second or maybe it was a third time. And for the second or maybe it was the third time, a judge denied his request. However, the canvassing board in St. Lucie County, realizing that there were some problems, to put it lightly, with the counting of the early votes, said, okay, you know what? A recount is warranted here. And you know what happened? The recount actually increased Patrick Murphy's lead over Alan West. I kid you not. Here, this is from Politico. And let me just read it to you. Florida Representative Alan West's reelection prospects grew dimmer Sunday as a recount of early ballots showed him falling further behind his Democratic opponent. Democrat Patrick Murphy, a 29-year-old construction company executive, gained 242 votes after the St. Lucie County Supervisor of Elections completed its retabulation, increasing his lead to more than 2,100 votes over West, a Tea Party hero. Murphy's lead is just outside the 0.5% margin that would trigger an automatic district-wide recount under Florida under Florida law. Boy, that was a Freudian slip, huh? West won a legal battle Friday when the office's canvassing board decided to retally all early votes that had been cast. The Republican had argued that those votes had been accidentally double-counted on election night and provided a winning margin to Murphy. But with Murphy's margin growing after the recount, West's legal options appeared to narrow. So sad. With St. Lucie County having a noon deadline Sunday for certifying its election results, Murphy's campaign argued that the election was effectively over. Now, Florida has a Tuesday deadline for certifying the results from all three counties that make up the 18th congressional district. By state law, he is effectively the winner, Eric Johnson, a senior Murphy advisor, said in an interview. Now, West's campaign manager, Tim Edson, said the advisors would be spending the coming hours assessing the vote totals. He did not specify whether the congressman had any plans to concede. Advisors said it was unlikely any decision would come Sunday. We're going to take a look at where things stand, Edson said. If we believe the results are fair and accurate, we're going to decide how to move forward. That decision has not been made. Wait, really? Listen to this. If we believe the results are fair and accurate, we're going to decide how to move forward. If the results are fair and accurate, you concede. Isn't that how it works? I think we need to call Alan West's office again. West.house.gov. All right. Yeah, and Jeremy Jewett just tweeted, all future Alan West headlines should say something like, Tea Party representative refuses to give up federal government paycheck. I think that works. All right, I think we need to call Alan West's office, and let's do it. Dun, dun. Hold on, let me copy the number. Let's get up my dialer here, call phones. Oh, no. Okay, there we go. All right, so we're calling Alan West's office in Washington, D.C. Last time we tried calling, of course, it was
Congressman Alan West's office.
Hi, my name's Nicole Sandler. I'm actually a constituent calling from the 22nd district, so the current district that Alan West kind of represents. I do a radio show. We're on the air, and I just wondered why Congressman West hasn't conceded yet, because he got his recount, and it should be over, right? I mean, he got the recount, and actually his challenger, the margin separating the two has widened, right? So it's time for him to concede, isn't it?
I'm actually going to have to go ahead and direct you to our press secretary.
Okay, cool. Who's that? What is that, Angela?
Nope, that's Michelle Hickford.
Oh, okay. Is Angela not there anymore?
Right now all the media is going through Michelle
okay.
Hickford.
Okay, Michelle Hickford. Cool.
Mm-hmm.
All right, thank you.
Bye.
It's not, oh, she hung up on me. I thought she was going to transfer me. Hold on. We need to call her back because I thought she was going to transfer me. Dun, 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 dun.
Congressman Alan West's office.
Hi, I thought you were going to transfer me to Michelle Hickford.
Nope. If I can go ahead and give you her email.
Sure.
Okay. So that's Michelle, M-I-C-H-E-L-E.
Uh-huh.
Dot Hickford,
okay.
H-I-C-K-F-O-R-D.
Right.
At mail.house.gov.
Mail.house.gov. Okay. All right, cool. All right. Well, I'm sorry you're going to be out of work, but I'm glad he is.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome. Bye.
Bye.
Yeah. See, I was all for a recount because, again, I want to make sure every vote is counted. But with every vote counted, Alan West, it's sad, but Alan West is still a... Yeah, he's a loser. Okay, so there's my Alan West thing to be continued because, you know, he just wants to keep spending the taxpayer money. All right. Now, I'll tell you, I've followed this story sort of gleefully, it's a weird disconnect when it comes to this whole General Petraeus thing because, honestly, I don't want to know about Petraeus' sex life. I really, really, really don't. But you know who explained it beautifully this weekend? Bill Maher. Yeah. So Bill Maher, if you don't have HBO, stand by because Bill Maher had a great show on Friday night. And the first thing he did, he opened with his, Griffin Darkletter, sorry, I got to go. In the chat room, Griffin Darkletter saying it took a bit of a debate with Brad, of course, Brad of Brad Blog, to get you over to accepting the recount, remember? No, see, here's the thing. All along, I knew deep, you know, if it were anybody but Alan West, I would have been screaming for a recount. But I am a bit biased when it comes to Alan West, because for those of you who are just joining us who don't know the story, I really can't stand the man. You know, he had me arrested, right? I should call his local office. Yeah, maybe tomorrow. So I went to something billed as a town hall meeting, which wasn't. And when I tried to ask a question, I got, you know, escorted out by an off-duty Fort Lauderdale police officer hired by the West campaign, or perhaps it was by the Calvary Chapel megachurch at which Alan West was in cahoots and held this event. Excuse me. Bottom line is, you know, the guy had me arrested, laughed about the fact that I spent the night in jail and was maced while in the custody of the Broward Sheriff's Office. By the way, Broward County Sheriff fired. Yeah, he was voted out too. Just thought I'd tell you. So, yeah, that's the only reason. And, you know, when I spoke to Brad again, I realized that what's right is right. and if the situations were reversed, that I'd be screaming for a recount. And so I am anything but a hypocrite. And, you know, they can't level that at me. And I knew that once every vote was counted, Alan West would lose fair and square because he sucks, because he's a war criminal, because he has no business holding elected office in this country. And the people of Florida, you know what? They screwed up. They screwed up with Alan West. They screwed up with Rick Scott. They screwed up with a lot of things, but they're coming around. You know, I think that's what happens with the American people. We get it. It just takes a while sometimes. So, Alan West, bye-bye. Here, let's sing. Ready? We can all sing together. This is for Alan West.
So long, farewell, I'll be the same. Adieu,
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 to you. Alan West, to you. Goodbye, you. Yeah. All right, so anyway. All right, any more questions from the chat room before I move on? So here's the thing. General Petraeus, yes, Buckeye Ken, believe it or not, or Robert Hill in New York City, Petraeus has a sex life. Who knew? And I don't want to really even think about David Petraeus' sex life. I mean, ew. You and ew. Yeah. So, and so I really stayed away from it because I honestly, it's none of our business. And there is an issue with the fact that we are, you know, the FBI is reading our emails. There's an issue there. So, yeah, I mean, look, I jump on stories that are worth talking about, but I, yeah, so I've stayed away from this. But I got to tell you, Bill Maher did a great job just outlining it all for us. So here you go.
I hate to bring you bad news for the last show, but things are spiraling out of control in Israel. There's a deadly rocket and airstrike battle going on with Hamas over Gaza. Looks like there may be another war in the Middle East. But don't worry, our best generals are on it.
Oh, snap.
You know, right after they finish fucking the Kardashians.
True, right? And can I just say, the city of North Miami is giving the Kardashian sisters the key to the city today? Just had to get
mail.
That out there.
Really? It's a shame we have to leave now, just as this scandal is getting started. But let me, you know, we've just hit it, this thing as it came over, but now
right.
We've got a whole week. Let me fill you in on what happened.
Okay,
really. Here
we go.
The whole thing started when General Petraeus, you know General Petraeus, our most celebrated general since Eisenhower. He was the commander in Iraq and then Afghanistan, then they put him at head of the CIA. Well, he's a married guy, but, you know, he decided he needed his biography written, so we got this hot married cougar named Pussy Galore.
Yeah,
no,
sort of.
No, I'm sorry, that's wrong.
Yeah.
Named Paula Broadwell to write his biography, so they had to spend long hours together talking about him. Well, one thing led to his cock, and...
yeah.
They started fucking. Now, I don't care that they started fucking.
Neither.
I do sort of care that the CIA director can't keep a secret.
Yeah, right?
This bothers me.
Me too.
Okay.
Okay.
Apparently, when he said the surge is working, he didn't even know his phone was on. So.
Ooh.
But, okay, the plot thickens. Apparently, this Paula Broadwell was not the only Broadwell who was interested in General Petraeus. Because
right.
down in Tampa, where we have our central command, you know, this is where the military is sort of militarized, there was this glorified gypsy grifter named Jill Kelly, who's part Kardashian, part Palin, and part Snooki.
Ooh. But good description, right? Right.
Who was hanging around the military bases, the media calls her a Tampa socialite. What is that, really?
Good question.
Someone who goes
Florida.
To Applebee's and orders the filet?
Oh!
Okay, so...
Ouch. Ow.
So, Jill... So listen to this. So Jill Kelly, the Tampa socialite, starts getting these anonymous threatening emails from someone. Of course, it turned out to be Paula Broadwell, you know, telling her to stay away from my general. Because if there's one thing a mistress hates, it's a guy who cheats.
Right?
So Jill Kelly is freaked out by these emails, so she calls up this FBI agent guy she knows who's trying to fuck her, I think. I'm only, you know, surmising that because he was an anti-Obama hothead who had previously sent her a picture of himself with no shirt on.
Creepy,
but
right?
Wait, it's not that bad. His cover was he was a greeter at Abercrombie & Fitch. So that's... Okay. No, he sends her this picture. He's trying to look all buff, but he has no nipples.
Really?
That's true. It's not really part of the story that's important, but okay.
I didn't know that.
But, you know.
Yeah. Okay.
So she's getting threatening emails, calls the FBI guy. You know, it's one thing if a flirty girl tries to get you to, you know, fix her flat tire. I can't do it. Would you? She's asking an FBI agent no nipples, to read a private citizen's emails. And he does. Because, of course, the FBI's job in this day and age is to find out who's having sex with who in America and record it so J. Edgar Hoover's ghost can jack off in hell.
Oh! Ooh. Wow. Okay. See, this is why I love Bill Maher. All right. Keep going.
As the FBI is looking through all these emails, that's when they discover... Not only the Petraeus affair, that's when they discovered that, but also that another one of our generals, General John Allen, who's only running the war in Afghanistan, is having some sort of cyber-sexy relationship with Jill Kelly. Apparently this chick is flirting with everyone but General Motors.
Right?
And by the way, she's also the reason why Colonel Sanders is always licking his fingers.
Oh, best line of the monologue.
Don't blame me. No, this is this is why I agree with the gays when they say we should not allow heterosexuals in the military. I'm telling you.
There you go.
But, okay. Now, to be fair, we don't know if General Allen was having actual sex with Jill Kelly, but they exchanged hundreds of emails like teenagers. No wonder why we lost the war in Afghanistan. General, what are your orders? Jesus, doesn't anybody knock? I'm working on a counterintelligence plan on my computer right now.
All right.
Hand me that box of tissues. But wait. The best part of this, of course, is the politics of it.
Listen to this.
A Republican, went to the Republican National Convention, where she fucked Clint Eastwood. No. Her opening line was, is this chair taken?
Okay.
So she's a Republican. General Petraeus, that's the guy the Republicans wanted to run for president. Paula Broadwell, they wanted to run her for Senate on the Republican side. The whole scandal happened because Jill Kelly was flirting with a super partisan right-winger FBI agent who took the emails, by the way, to his Republican congressman, who then took them to House Majority Leader Republican Eric Cantor. You know who I blame? Obama.
So that was Bill Maher sort of putting the whole Petraeus affair into context. And so who was fucking who was emailing who was spying on who. And I just looked at this shirtless picture of the FBI guy and I see nipples. Sorry. There are nipples there. They're kind of the same color as his skin, but they're small nipples, but nipples nonetheless. I don't know where Bill Maher, I guess Bill Maher is a nipple man. Anyway, so that's Bill Maher's take on the Petraeus affair, as it was an affair. But to me, it sounds like a soap opera, the whole thing. Now, here's my conundrum here. I watch a soap opera. When I was a kid, I started watching One Life to Live, which is ABC's now defunct soap opera. It's been gone almost a year. I used to watch General Hospital. It got really bad, and One Life to Live got really good, right? So I'm going somewhere with this, so bear with me. But once One Life to Live was taken off the air, they hired the executive producer and writing staff for General Hospital. They even brought over some of the characters. And the thing about this Frank Valenti guy, who is the head writer and the producer, I guess, now of General Hospital, is that he doesn't take himself seriously. They know it's a soap opera. They know it's absurd. They know it's funny. People come back from the dead. And just this week, they've had like three people come back from the dead on General Hospital. And they are resurrecting old characters that, you know, people who during the Luke and Laura days, yes, Ron, I do remember Luke and Laura, that they were around back then. So they're bringing all these people back from the dead. That's the thing about soap operas. They're supposed to be absurd. And now, you know, in the 2000s, they have a sense of humor about it. This thing is too much like a real life soap opera. So if somebody like were to write this story as Bill Maher just laid it out there, you'd go, this is ridiculous. This could never happen. If a screenwriter wrote this and submitted the script, it would be rejected because it's too far-fetched. Truth is stranger than fiction. It is. It really is. So, of course, who's going to take this angle on the story? You guessed it. Stephen Colbert.
Ever since former CIA director David Petraeus revealed his torrid affair, the scandal has the entire newscape in a tizzy.
It's the sex scandal that's rocked Washington.
A salacious sex scandal involving the now former CIA director.
Breaking new details on the fast-moving CIA sex scandal.
We have to talk about the fiscal cliff, but I'm dying to ask you about this scandal.
Amazing.
Because it's all anyone's talking about.
Yeah, wonder why.
This sex scandal is all anyone in Washington can talk about. I wonder why the country's in financial ruin.
Good point, Colbert.
Now, folks, I may be a news junkie, but I also gots to have my stories. And this is both. It's like a steamy episode of General's Hospital.
General's Hospital.
These days, folks, I spend my afternoons, you know, plopped on the couch in a house coat, watching CNN with a Virginia Slim in one hand and a box of After Eights in the other. I don't care if the news goes straight to my hips. It is me time. And folks, this story has got everything. A decorated war hero who's now America's spy master has an affair with his own sexy biographer,
right,
who thinks the spy master is stepping out on her with a second girlfriend. So she sends an email from a secret account saying, step off or I will cut a biatch. And the second hottie freaks out and contacts her friend, an FBI agent,
right,
who launches an investigation but gets pulled off the case because he sexed her a shirtless photo. Meanwhile, the spy master's protege, also a general, has sent thousands of emails to the second woman. This isn't just a love triangle, folks. It's a love pentagon.
Right. Oh!
Colbert,
that's why he makes the big bucks, right?
I gotta say, after that, it gets a little far-fetched. I mean,
after that,
all of a sudden, the second woman has an emotionally troubled identical twin. And both the spy master and the general write letters of support for the twin sister's custody battle with her ex.
Right.
Oh, and listen to the name they came up with for him. Grayson Wolf.
Okay.
Jimmy, we don't have a picture of him yet, so just put up a visual approximation.
Yeah, should have cut this out. Sorry. Visual.
Good.
Radio.
Yeah, that's right.
Visual radio.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay.
Folks, I just gotta say, it's just not believable anymore.
I think
the news has jumped the shark. And the most unbelievable part, they say that the general down there, that general over there, he is the top commander of our war in Afghanistan. Afghanistan? Really?
Really?
Please, if our troops were really still fighting in Afghanistan, don't you think we'd be hearing about that on the news instead of all this bullshit?
Yeah, you think?
Anyway.
You think? Hello. Wow. Anyway.
Anyway, bottom line, it's a soap opera, and it is done. We should all move on.
Oh, this is far from over, Stephen.
Enters Susan Lucci. Miss Soap Opera, for those who don't know.
Susan Lucci!
Oh, yes. And there's more. General Petraeus has developed amnesia and can't remember that he's pregnant.
Oh, my God.
By his own evil twin, who's in a coma and is my lover.
And that was just a look, you know, one of those pregnant, like, soap opera looks from Colbert. Okay.
That doesn't make any sense.
No.
How dare you?
And she smacked him from across the room. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. How did you do that from over there?
Don't you remember?
Don't you remember?
Sorry.
I was in a boating accident, and now I have telekinesis. Just like General Petraeus.
Oh. And it was another look. Soap opera look. I could have edited, you know, some of this. But I didn't. It was a soap opera look.
I still think it's bullshit.
Still think it's bullshit, too.
Yeah, you're probably right.
Susan Lucci, everybody. We'll be right back.
Anyway, so, you know, yeah. And that's why I really haven't done a whole lot with the Petraeus thing. Better to make fun of it because it is so absurd. But we will take a break here, quick break, and come back on the other side with Marcy Wheeler. You know her as Empty Wheel on Twitter and her website, emptywheel.net. And there are actually some issues being raised by this whole Petraeus affair, such as, do we have any privacy? So we'll talk about that and other causes of concern on the national security front with Marcy Wheeler, Empty Wheel. She joins us next. Still to come, Joshua Hirsch from Huffington Post will be here with the latest on the Israel-Gaza mess, and it is a mess. And Jason Leopold from truthout.org writes why this $4.5 billion settlement paid by BP is nothing. Is just a drop in the bucket, and BP really should get the corporate death penalty. All right? Okay. All that and more still to come. Don't go away. I'm Nicole Sandler. It's radio. Or not.
This is the Media Matters Minute. I'm Albert Klein. Mitt Romney recently claimed that President Obama won re-election by giving gifts, such as health care and affordable education, to voters. Here are Stuart Varney and Brian Kilmeade reacting.
We're throwing the handouts out, left, right, and center.
Mitt Romney mentioned that yesterday.
Right? Yeah, that's what we're
doing. He says he couldn't win because all these other people were giving things away.
Buying votes with taxpayer money, handouts all over the place. We're going to tax the rich to pay for it.
Of course, Fox agreed. The network has been pushing the narrative that some Americans are takers since long before Mitt Romney made his comments. Here, for example, is Andrew Napolitano in 2011.
Dependency is turning this country from a nation of makers who come up with new ideas, who employ new people, who risk their wealth and create wealth, into a nation of takers who primarily consume other people's wealth.
For more on this and other stories, please visit MediaMatters.org.
This is the Media Matters Minute. I'm Jeremy Holden. During his Fox News radio program, a caller asked host Brian Kilmeade where Fox found their female on-air talent. Let's take a listen.
Well, you and all the women of Fox, I don't know who was the scout that got you guys, but they rock.
It was Brian.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. That's very sweet.
It was actually, we went to the Victoria's Secret catalog and we said, can any of these people talk?
Sure.
Of course, Kilmeade frequently offers sexist commentary during his Fox and Friends hosting duties, even prompting co-host Gretchen Carlson to walk off set in protest.
Women are everywhere. We're letting them play golf and tennis now. It's out of control.
You know what?
You know.
You know what?
She's out.
You read the headlines, since men are some great.
Kilmeade's latest comments should come as little surprise. As Media Matters has previously reported, Fox News chief Roger Ailes has said that he's considered whether a woman is attractive enough for on-air work. For more on this and other stories, please visit MediaMatters.org.
John McKay, singing his way into the hearts of voters across the country.
Bum, 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 Iran. Bum, 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 Iran.
Anyway, I think Iran is a great threat. The Iranians are continuing their efforts to acquire a nuclear weapon.
Bum, 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 Iran. Bomb, 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 Iran.
After a restful vacation in the Middle East paradise of Iraq, he packed a bag, Dad, and his cheeks to embark on a Beach Boy straitjacket tour.
Wouldn't it be nice to have mutually assured destruction so everyone can have bombs fall on their head? As your overlord, I will have no compunction to thank you for your vote by making you dead.
It's not nice to poke fun at the mentally handicapped, so let the old man wear out the war hero welcome mat.
My brain sunk down to my cheeks, where I stored nuts and many other things. There's plenty of room for my wallet, car keys, and even a wristwatch. Ain't I a crazy a-hole?
McCain's message is clear, if you listen carefully to the voices inside his cheeks.
God only knows when we're getting Armageddon. They're my cigarettes. My cigarettes. Yes. They're my cigarettes. They're my They're my cigarettes.
Another Boca Brittany production.
I'm David Schuster, and this is the Nicole Sandler Show on RadioOrNot.com.
Yes, it is. Thank you, David. All right, let's get Marcy Wheeler on the line. Hopefully this will work. We're calling Marcy Wheeler. Find her at emptywheel.net on Twitter as at emptywheel. And there she is. Good morning, Marcy.
Hey, how are you?
I'm doing well. And you?
Oh, I'm doing okay.
Good. You know, I just did a whole intro thing here playing both Bill Maher's sort of walking us through his monologue from Friday night where he walked us through the entire Petraeus scandal and then Stephen Colbert's visit from Susan Lucci on the soap opera. And you wrote a piece the other day at emptywheel.net, What If It Were the Real Muslim Housewives of Tampa Bay Scandal. Would that be worthy of covering?
Well, I mean, what I was trying to... one of the laudable responses to this whole Petraeus scandal is people saying, wow, the FBI has amazing powers of surveillance, even with almost no criminal predicate.
Right.
In other words, I mean, what it has done, I think, is scared a lot of people in D.C. about how this surveillance could, you know, come back to expose their own little dalliances, of which I assume we have tons in D.C. So
you think? Yeah.
That's great. but as much as I like that and some people I love, Julian Sanchez, Chris Segoyan, some really good civil libertarians have been commenting on that. I wanted to push that a little further and say what happened to Petraeus is not the worst that can happen.
Okay.
So in other words, yes, Petraeus was targeted, and I think they got from cyber stalking to Petraeus via counterintelligence. Counterintelligence, counter cyber, counter hacking. In other words, they continued to pursue Petraeus because they were worried that a top general or two top generals or three top generals were being hacked. And Paula Broadwell's emails looked not dissimilar from the way that people in the national security establishment have been hacked. So, you know, to some degree he was targeted because he's such a high-level national security person. To some degree he was targeted because he is in the chain of command for the nuclear football. And all that is not true of your average Muslim, but there are things that would have happened to your average Muslim that didn't happen to Petraeus, which I think makes our big brother worse.
Well, you're right, because I think your average Muslim probably is, you know, has no privacy. We have an expectation of privacy when we send out an email, but what we've learned is there is none. In fact, one thing that I've learned from this whole mess is, first of all, we know it's no longer the way it used to be, where when you get emails, it's all downloaded from the server onto your computer. Now, most of it lives in the cloud somewhere, whatever that cloud might be. If you use Gmail, which is apparently what at least Alan and Jill Kelly were using for their thousands of email correspondence, it all lives up in there in the cloud. And if an email sits for 6 months, then it's fair game. If an email is sitting on the cloud for 6 months, then anybody can go look at it.
It's stored communication. Yeah. No, I mean there's a whole range of ways they can get these communications, and most of them don't entail a warrant.
Right.
They entail a subpoena, and most of them. I mean, the big question in this case is how the FBI got into the emails without having to give notice to Broadwell or Petraeus that they were getting in there. But again, I think that there's enough tie to counter hacking and counter espionage that's not. I don't think the bar was that high. All that's assuming, I think Muslims would be more exposed because they're more likely to get picked up in their traffic. Another thing that this scandal shows is, as important as the content is, so Paula Broadwell's email, eventually they got to her sexy time emails with Petraeus,
right.
And the FBI read one that said something about under the desk, and they assumed that was corruption. In fact, it had to do with having sex under the
aye,
desk.
Aye, aye, aye.
But as important as the content is, something people should take away from the scandal with is the knowledge that your metadata is just as telling. So they got to Paula Broadwell not necessarily by reading her emails, but by instead taking the IP address of where all of the emails were sent. She had used cyber cafes to try and hide her tracks, but what they were able to do, presumably with, again, subpoenas to hotels that are very easy to do and don't require notice, what they almost certainly did was take the IP addresses showing the geographic location from which the emails were sent and cross-referencing them with the guest registries of the hotels from which they were sent.
Yeah.
So you didn't even need any content. Paula Broadwell didn't have to say, I'm sitting here in a hotel in Colorado dreaming of you. Instead, just the metadata was enough for the FBI to determine that it was her.
So now, again, Marcy Wheeler is with us. At emptywheel.net is where you find her on Twitter, at emptywheel. So Jill Kelly was getting these emails from Paula Broadwell. Paula Broadwell, is that right? And Paula Broadwell was jealous that Jill Kelly might have been flirting with the guy she was fucking on the side. Both she's married and Petraeus is married.
Everybody's married.
Right, everybody's married.
But let me interrupt, because the first ones actually didn't come from Jill, weren't sent to Jill Kelly. They were sent to General Allen and possibly Petraeus, and the AP reported this morning some other generals. And I think one of the things, if Paula Broadwell ever gets charged and she has to defend her actions in court, I think what she's going to say is she was working from, not out of jealousy per se, but counterintelligence, kind of a self-appointed I'm not kidding. I mean,
but it's so ridiculous. She also had like diplomatic immunity, right? She's the one who called 911 and said, I'm an ambassador of sorts and there are people on my lawn, right?
Well, that's Jill Kelly. I think what Paula Broadwell did was see what a lot of us are seeing after the fact. See this woman, Jill Kelly, who she's Lebanese born. Paula Broadwell has ties to some neocons, so you've got a neocon seeing a Lebanese-born Arab-speaking woman in incredible debt, doing a lot of things to get close to people in power. You know, these big parties she was doing in Tampa Bay. She was working the angles to get into the White House, top donors of both the Republican and Democratic Party, and I think somebody who's involved in intelligence, as Paula Broadwell is, looks at that and says that's a tremendous counterintelligence risk.
Huh.
And maybe she had reasons to suspect Kelly beyond what I've just laid out. But on paper, Jill Kelly looks like a tremendous counterintelligence risk. She looks like somebody who a foreign government may be paying to get close to the top people in our national security establishment. So I'm not trying to make excuses for Paula Broadwell because I think she was nutty, but I do think that if she ever has to explain herself in court, what she's going to say is, this woman was infiltrating our national security and I tried to stop it.
Wow. So you think it all it came from that, and not just, you know, a jealous woman thinking that someone was stepping in on her affair?
Right, because there's no indication that Paula Broadwell was sleeping with General Allen, and he's the first one who responded. So he gave the emails to Kelly, to Jill Kelly, because the pseudonym, they were called the Kelly Patrol. So he went to Kelly and said, do you know anything about this? And then subsequently she started getting emails from Broadwell and apparently some other generals. So Broadwell was not just upset that Jill Kelly was caressing General Petraeus under the table, or, you know, that's she seems to be upset, or she seems to have been upset that Jill Kelly was insinuating herself into this Tampa Bay community and getting very close to top people in our national security.
Wow. Do you think that, you know, given that we have no expectation of privacy anymore, are we going to see these emails, especially these ones that might come out that shows that there was actually some counterintelligence stuff going on here and it wasn't just salacious who's fucking who?
Well, I don't want to credit that Paula Broadwell was justified in doing that. I mean,
right.
She believed there was a counterintelligence problem. I think the proper thing to do would be to contact military counterintelligence and have them investigate it rather than trying to send, you know, she didn't do the right thing in any case.
Right.
But,
right.
But I'm guessing that that's going to be her ultimate explanation. And her father at one point was interviewed and said, oh, you know, it's something entirely different from what it looks like. So maybe I'm being overly generous to Paula Broadwell, but I suspect that's going to be her ultimate.
Well, I hear you. And actually, the thing that we've heard is that the FBI got involved because Jill Kelly turned over these threatening emails she had gotten from Paula Broadwell to this FBI macho man who sent her, you know, who was flirting with her because he wanted to stop her. And that he then took these emails, which were threatening, and took them to someone in Congress who took them to Eric Cantor. And I mean, so maybe the picture we're hearing is totally wrong.
I think there's, you know, we may never get a full picture of this, but I think we're getting a very limited picture. The FBI guy, he definitely was not acting as a proper whistleblower. Had he been, he should have gone to, say, Lamar Smith, who is on HJC. He's the ranking, for the next couple of weeks, he's the ranking member on the House Judiciary Committee with oversight over FBI. He would be, or Charles Grassley, who is easily the best friend of whistleblowers in
right
in
and
either
because
house.
Right and that we well Sybil Edmonds has been on the show a couple of times and he was actually very open to her concerns as a whistleblower but in the end did nothing.
He has oversight over FBI, so if you believe there's a problem with FBI,
that's
you go to somebody on the Judiciary Committees, or in this case, because it involved intelligence issues, you go to somebody, you go to Mike Rogers on the House Intelligence Committee. He didn't do that. Instead, he went to a partisan hack.
Right. And I hear the whole thing is kind of crazy. And yet, Marcy Wheeler, here we are talking about this again because sex is involved and because there is this soap opera aspect to it. So let me pivot, because the other story that features Petraeus is Benghazi. And let me ask you this. Is there any there, or is this a Fox bullshit made up controversy?
Both.
Okay.
It is a Fox bullshit made up controversy. There was a Craig Unger, who has great historian on Karl Rove, had a source come to him around September 25th,
uh-huh,
and say they have a Jimmy Carter strategy. They are trying to turn this Benghazi thing into Obama's Jimmy Carter, into his October surprise. So the Republicans were very consciously cultivating a scandal in Benghazi that doesn't exist. They were leaking stuff to the press and claiming that what they were leaking said one thing, when if you looked at it, it said something different.
Mm-hmm.
And underlying their efforts to make it into a scandal, and this is where it begins to get a little bit real, is that the CIA was trying to hide what they were doing in Benghazi. You know, rightly so. They're the CIA.
Right.
Stupidly, of course, they had already exposed themselves to the militias that attacked them. So after the attack, it's not entirely clear who they were hiding it from, because the bad guys already knew American citizens didn't. That's what always happens with the CIA, is that the bad guys have it figured out, and the CIA doesn't want the American people to understand what's really going on. And so for an entire month and a half, the CIA and therefore the State Department were hiding that this was primarily about attacking American intelligence, not just attacking the U.S. ambassador.
Right.
And so I think that made it a lot easier to make it look like a scandal, because the CIA was telling fibs. You know, the big scandal is Susan Rice said X, Y, and Z on TV. The reason she did so is because somebody within the intelligence community took out any references to terrorism, and therefore she was made to look less smart than she otherwise would have. And that's justifiable. I mean, I did a post this morning basically pointing out that we know there were intercepts. The intercepts got revealed by the press, and shortly thereafter, one of the culprits from the attack tried to run away. So, you know, we know that if you expose, and same thing going back to 9/11, I mean, when you expose that you've got NSA intercepts on terrorist voice communications, mm-hmm. you don't want to disclose that, because then they're going to stop using that phone line.
All right. So is this why the whole any reference to this being a terrorist attack was taken out of the briefing that the CIA gave Susan Rice?
That's my guess. That's my guess, is that which is stupid, again.
Right.
Because, you know, Al-Qaeda, Ansar al-Sharia, AQIM, they all know we're looking for them. So you could have easily said, oh, we think they're, you know, the group has ties to AQIM, we think. And frankly, the extremist militias in Libya were accusing us of launching a drone strike in June, and certainly were aware of our drone surveillance of them. Not in Benghazi, but in a different city in the east. So they were aware that we were surveilling them, you know, and we knew that they were aware we were surveilling them. So it's kind of not all that credible to say, well, we can't let them know that we're surveilling them at all.
Mm-hmm.
Although I am very sympathetic to the notion that we shouldn't tell them which phone lines we have tapped.
Okay, that one makes sense. But to say that no, you can't have a. You can't deny it was a terrorist attack, to say that it was this sort of grassroots uprising over the stupid video, you know, that's going a bit overboard. But it's not the deception, this crazy controversy that, you know, that Fox is alleging. As you say, you know, Craig Unger was actually on the show a couple of weeks ago, but talking about Karl Rove, not necessarily this Benghazi Jimmy Carter moment that the right is trying to fabricate. Right. Yeah. But this is what they do. I mean, the whole thing over Susan Rice is ridiculous. The whole, you know, it's so frustrating looking at what they do. The whole John McCain firewall that they're throwing up against Susan Rice. We don't even know if Susan Rice is going to be Obama's nominee for Secretary of State. But the fact that anybody that he puts up, John McCain is going to be Mr. Obstructionist. He's just a crazy old coot at this point, right?
Well, except that the Republican, I mean, who have the Republicans attacked in the Obama administration? Susan Rice, Valerie Jarrett, Shirley Sherrod,
Eric Holder. Yeah, all black people.
All black people. So this isn't, I mean, at some point, we have to get beyond politesse and just say, look, the Republicans refuse to have black people in any position of authority. And they keep inventing these scandals to try and prevent that from happening. I mean, that's one thing that's going on. But there is a there in Benghazi insofar as, at the very least, it should generate a conversation about what the proper balance between security and militarism is. And Chris Stevens actually was, you know, he didn't want a big military footprint. He wanted some more security, but he didn't want a big military footprint. I fear that one of the things that's going to come, you know, we in Afghanistan and Iraq, we had big military footprints, and that was wrong because it walled us off from the people and prevented us from doing anything to establish stability. In Libya, we're trying the opposite, and then you had Benghazi happen, and it would be terrible if, as a result, we reverted back to what we did in Iraq and Afghanistan, and the Republicans, that's sort of their default, is must have more guns. But there also ought to be a legitimate conversation about how we do nation building. I mean, if for better or worse, if Gaddafi, somebody like Gaddafi, if Assad is ever overthrown, how do you go about ensuring that a stable country that represents the will of its people one way or another takes place rather than gets taken over by extremists? And that's what we're facing in Libya right now. And we're not having that conversation because we're too busy talking about Susan Rice's talking points.
Right, exactly. It seems like they're always trying to distract us from what actually might be a real issue. For instance, and let me go back to the Petraeus affair again, is there, and I, you know, again, as someone who I don't do a lot with national security, and my eyes sort of glaze over, but, I mean, it sounds like this might be just sort of a, you know, the ongoing conflict between the CIA and the FBI.
There is that. I mean, remember that as this was happening, the CIA was refusing to give the FBI their video from the attack in Benghazi.
Wow.
Now, I don't think, I think it's more likely, I mean, I would say more broadly, it reflects the tensions among our national security entities. I think the tensions between DOD and CIA are actually even more pressing behind this. And you see, the Wall Street Journal has been particularly good on this, for example, and even between state and CIA, but I think the key is between DOD and CIA, because CIA, one of the other things that went wrong, besides not having enough security in Benghazi, is that we did not have a very good sense of who the militias we were working with. You know, it is in the nature of our intelligence to invest our human intelligence efforts into the bad guys rather than into the people we believe to be our partners and may not be entirely reliable. Does that make sense?
Yes, no, it does. And, you know, that's the other bottom line here, is that when our consulates and embassies, and please correct me if I'm wrong here, around the world, they depend on the host country for security. And in this case, it was the local militias. Now, look, Libya is in turmoil. Gaddafi's out. There is no stable government there. And so there are militias of all sorts. How do we know who the hell we're working with? And, you know, again, correct me if I'm wrong, there was some argument in the House on Friday over, I think it was Congressman Gary Ackerman of New York was screaming, look, House Republicans, if you want to know who's to blame here, it's you, because you're the ones who cut funding for security for embassies and consulates around the world. Another one of these false, you know, memes from the right is that Obama turned down their extra security that they asked for. Did they even ask for extra security for the consulates, or was it just for the embassies?
They asked for a team to remain in Libya that had been there through the summer, and the State Department was trying to do precisely what we're trying to do in Afghanistan, which is get the local country to take over the security. And the people, the militia in question, the February 17 Brigade, which is the militia we were relying on, had been reliable. If you go back and you look at the State Department reports, they had been reliable in incident after incident after incident, so we had reason to believe they were again. Right now, we don't know how reliable they were because there's conflicting reporting whether you're depending on a State Department source, a CIA source, or a local Libyan source, and that, I think, is one of the questions we should be focusing on, because for a number of reasons, and also, I mean, General Petraeus, you know, one of the benefits of this scandal is that it has taken the luster off his myth,
yes,
his self-created myth.
Good.
And one of the things we've returned focus on is how his effort to train in Iraq, his effort to train in Afghanistan, both have been failures. And in fact, it seems that the CIA was in charge of training these militias as well. So one of the underlying questions that we should bring away from this is, do we really know what we're doing when we're arming local militias, training them, and yet not vetting them well enough to ensure that they're not going to turn on us. That, I mean, I'm not saying that the militia, that the good guy militia in Libya did that, but there are allegations that they didn't provide the support that, that we expected them to. And so, you know, another thing that this needs to, you know, is David, did David Petraeus fail three times in three different countries when trying to train militias and get the country to take over their own security?
Wow. But now there's this effort on to say, hey, you know, it's hard to get good generals, and so what? David Petraeus was stupping some woman on the side. That shouldn't disqualify him from running the CIA. I mean, he's a great general. They're working on trying to, you know, put the luster back on. Is this something we should let happen?
Yeah, you got to say this for Paula Broadwell. She was doing... she was only more literally fucking David Petraeus than everybody else in D.C.
Right.
Because they're all every bit as...
They were just giving him a blowjob.
Yeah, and I think, I mean, again, one thing Mark Ambender did this report on the fact that Petraeus is in the chain of command for the nuclear football. And that is one reason why it is not okay to have an affair and try and hide that affair using counter surveillance techniques that you learn from terrorists. That's the problem. You know, I don't care how illustrious your career was or wasn't, and we can argue about that, but it is a problem for somebody who has that kind of authority to expose himself. There's another detail that I only noticed last night, and really hasn't gotten a lot of notice, but in an AP report published Friday night or Saturday, they described basically a law, you know, an FBI source, anonymous source, told them that Petraeus didn't admit to the affair until his October 26th interview, which they said, the AP said, was his second interview, suggesting that he did not come clean the first time he was asked about this.
By who? With an interview with who?
With the FBI.
Oh, okay.
So in other words, you know, we've been told that both Broadwell and Petraeus admitted they had this affair to the FBI. It may in fact be the case that they didn't admit it at first. They were trying to hide it at first.
Right.
And if that's the case, then clearly he can't be in a position of national security because he's doing the same kind of stuff that Scooter Libby was doing.
Well, exactly. And as Bill Maher put it, look, I don't begrudge the guy, you know, fucking someone. I do have a problem with the fact that he can't keep a secret.
Well, it doesn't say much for us yet. I mean,
no, exactly.
You know, the other thing is, and this is, you know, I was pressing this in the first couple of days, but it's been sort of lost. But the Obama administration has treated people who have done things akin, certainly to what Paula Broadwell did, and probably to what Petraeus did. They have prosecuted them aggressively. You know, if you look at what happened to John Kiriakou, even more if you look at what happened to Thomas Drake. These whistleblowers in Thomas Drake's case, he was alleged falsely to have kept classified information in his basement. Well, we already know Paula Broadwell did far more than that, and yet the FBI pursued Drake for years, took away his security clearance, and it took a long time for the administration to do that with Paula Broadwell. And so, you know, one of the things that's going on, especially with General Petraeus, is that you've got this gross double standard. You know, the people who the national security establishment likes are treated with kid gloves, and the people who exposed the underbelly of the national security establishment are prosecuted. And that's wrong. We cannot have that and still claim that we have rule of law.
Yeah, well, there's a big question mark over that rule of law thing here.
Exactly.
Go ahead.
But I mean, that's one of the things. You know, Dianne Feinstein, after Petraeus' testimony Friday, talked about suffering people. And I'm kind of like, this is a woman who's in charge of the Senate Intelligence Committee. She's on the Senate Judiciary Committee. She's okayed all of this spying, right? So she's got to suck it up if one of her buddies gets caught, because that's how bad the surveillance is in this country. But she also needs to take a step back and realize that our law enforcement has gotten completely arbitrary. I mean, it always was to some degree. African Americans were always targeted in a way that white people weren't. But, you know, it has just gotten crazy. crazy arbitrary, largely around this nexus of national security, and that's a problem.
Wow. Well, that to be continued. I have a feeling maybe we'll see a lot more on that front, certainly from you. Marcy Wheeler, find her at emptywheel.net and on Twitter at emptywheel. I've got links to both on my blog at radioornot.com. Thank you so much for coming on this morning. I always appreciate your work.
Thanks, Nicole.
All right. Take care.
Take care.
Bye-bye. All right, we've got the news coming up. Lots to talk about with Victoria Jones in just a moment. And, wow, speak of the devil. I love it when my timing is on. I read the news today. Oh, boy. So, yes, as I said, Victoria Jones from the Talk Radio News Service there at talkradionews.com. Good morning, Victoria.
Hello.
How are you doing today?
I'm doing pretty good, I think. Thank you, considering...
Well, considering what? I mean, it's, boy, crazy stuff going on.
Crazy stuff, I know.
Should we start in the Middle East and Gaza and Israel? It's heartbreaking to see what's going on over there. I was actually listening to CNN this morning, and they had a reporter. I was in the car, so I didn't have the visual, but they had a reporter in Gaza who said, oops, I got to go. There's mortar coming in. I got to go take cover. Bye. I mean, really?
Yeah.
And
unbelievable.
Yeah. So we keep hearing talk of a ceasefire, and then no, not really, and then what's the latest? Do we know?
I would be very surprised if there was. Going to be a ceasefire imminently, like today.
Yeah.
UN Secretary General Ban Ki-moon is in Egypt today for talks, so that's a positive thing. And there's a delegation of Arab ministers in Gaza tomorrow, which I actually don't think is going to mean very much.
Okay.
But you never know. You never know. You never know what's going to be the breakthrough. And Senator John McCain, the ubiquitous Senator John McCain, is suggesting that Bill Clinton, somebody with enormous prestige, as he describes them, should be the person to go and try and mediate a possible ceasefire, which is actually not a bad idea. If anybody can, it would be somebody like Bill Clinton.
Right.
So the situation is that at the moment we don't have a ground war, but a ground invasion. But there are troops on standby very close to where they could go in. Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu is indicating that that could happen at any time. Benjamin Netanyahu is also facing re-election. You also have to bear in mind, you always have to look at the backdrops to these things.
Right.
Also, Hamas, on the other hand, is feeling a little emboldened by the Arab Spring, and so is making demands of Israel that it probably didn't feel able to make a year or 2 years ago of what it wants in exchange for into hostilities. And the demands that it's making are demands that are just never going to be met.
Right. No, I hear you. Meanwhile, as you write, at least 91 people in Gaza are now dead, including many children, 700 wounded, including 200 children. Three Israelis have been killed and 79 wounded. And who decides to stick his nose in it? Rupert Murdoch. Seriously? I mean, he tweeted yesterday or Saturday, why is Jewish-owned press so consistently anti-Israel in every crisis? Really?
Yes, that was probably not helpful. And he got a lot of blowback.
Good.
On that from the Jews.
From everyone.
And also from the Goyim, who rose up against him as well.
Good. As it should be. I mean,
yes,
really? Unbelievable. All right, so what else is happening?
Well, he apologized on Sunday.
Yeah.
In another tweet saying that he didn't see what he'd done wrong, but okay, he apologized unreservedly.
Well,
it's just like, really?
That's not an apology. It's like, I didn't do anything wrong, but if I offended you, I'm sorry. Yeah.
So that was just really weird. Meantime, President is in Cambodia.
Right.
He was in Burma earlier today.
Now, is it Burma or is it Myanmar? What's the name of this country?
U.S. government policy is to call it Burma.
Ah.
The ruling government itself calls it Myanmar, and the military government before that called it Myanmar. The government before that, before it was taken over by the military government, called it Burma.
Uh-huh.
So we have stuck with Burma because we didn't like what the military government did. Now, today, the president continued to call it Burma, although at one point, he called it Myanmar.
Okay.
That was not an error.
Okay.
That was a deliberate diplomatic hat tip.
Okay.
To say, okay, I'm making a gesture to you.
Okay.
I'm going to call you Myanmar once. How do you like that?
See, we can be nice.
Yeah. At right. the same time, he gave a nationally televised speech at the University of Rangoon, which is now called Yangon, in which he made some very stiff language about the need for more reform.
Okay.
He also met with Aung San Suu Kyi, the reformist and Nobel Peace Prize winner, who had urged him to come to Burma. They hugged, and she made an interesting comment about how the most trickiest time in reform is really this time, just when you think you're on the verge of change.
Okay. All right, what else is going on? What else do we need to know about today?
Well, we probably do need to know about Benghazi.
Okay. Yeah. What now? What's going on? Now, from as far as I could tell, from the interviews that members of Congress who were in on the two closed door hearings with Petraeus on Friday, it sounds like, you know, nobody did anything wrong. That, and what I just talked with Marcy Wheeler about sort of at length, is that Petraeus always believed that it was an act of terror, but because they didn't want to tip their hand to the terrorists, they took that part out of the cleared talking points that Susan Rice was given.
That is pretty much exactly what Petraeus said. So now what appears to be the case, I'm trying to report this dispassionately, what appears to be what is upsetting some is the question of who took out the language.
Right.
So the conspiracy now is that allegedly the White House took out the language, not the intelligence community. Although when you look at what Representative Peter King said when he came out of the hearing, of course, John McCain said nothing. He just ran out of the hearing and
right.
his family spoke, which indicates that he got what he wanted out of the hearing. Peter King indicated, and I've seen the transcript and seen him say it, that Petraeus answered the question and said that it was okayed by the CIA. So what they've been saying is those who believe there's a conspiracy to protect the president, that's what the conspiracy is about, so that he could get reelected, that the talking points were changed inside the White House so that for some reason this would not be said. Well, in the Washington Post today, there's an interesting piece right towards the end of a lengthy article about this, that says that senior intelligence officials are getting pretty ticked off because at the implication that the White House has rolled over on them and is saying, no, we actually hold three slots on what's known as the Deputies Committee, which is this committee of second-tier people inside the administration, the White House, whatever you like to call it, that would have been responsible for doing the editing. So there were three people from the intelligence community. I don't know which three it would have been, the CIA and two others. And they're saying, we did it,
mm-hmm.
not the White House. And they're getting quite offended that the work that they did is not being recognized.
Right. Good. Okay. Well, in this case, are they getting offended that the Republican Party is calling them out as perhaps treasonous or lying to the American people or doing something inherently wrong? Because if it's the White House doing it, that's what they're saying it was.
They're getting called out as just being sort of ignored for not being involved in the process. When I pointed out to a couple of my hosts this morning that this is what they're saying, they said, well, okay, so they were involved in doing it, but, you know, they're covering for the White House. They have to say that.
Oh,
really.
God. But the CIA? Since when is the CIA a political arm of the White House?
You see, the thing is that it doesn't matter what you say. It comes back down to they're covering for
the White House. Of course. And there's your, your hate wing radio stance. It's always a scandal from, Whitewater. They always have to throw up something. And you know what? In doing so, they might miss something that's really wrong. You know, like why we're spying on private citizens' emails and such. What's happening with the fiscal cliff, the so-called fiscal cliff?
Well, the cliff is sort of motionless this week, or basically motionless this week. There may be a bit of a talk. But it is lurching, meaning like the Tower of Pisa. Basically, the talks got off to a good start last week. Everybody's agreeing we want to get something done before the end of the year. There's obviously, not everybody is entire agreement about what that is. But the talks last week of the four principals and the president at the White House on Friday were very amicable, so that's really a very good start. What they've agreed to in principle is a compromise that will provide an immediate down payment of at least $50 billion to reduce this year's projected deficit. That would be in lieu of the automatic measures. And then also it would define a framework for negotiating a long-term grand bargain in 2013 to shave annual deficits by about $4 trillion over the next decade. Over the first decade.
Okay.
So that's what they're looking at, but they've got to find the way of getting there. But these four principals want to do it, but it's not only down to them. They've all got caucuses to report back to, and some of their caucuses are more difficult to negotiate than others.
All right, to be continued, and we're going to deal with this in great detail in the coming weeks. Obviously, of course, Congress came back for a day or two, and then they had to go home again because, after all, it's Thanksgiving on Thursday.
That's right. Everybody has to go home again.
Cabinet picks. The Wall Street Journal is reporting that President Obama may announce some of his picks for his new cabinets as early as next week.
This is interesting. There have been a few articles about cabinet picks that I've been reading, but this seemed the most well-researched to me, so this is the day I decided to go with it. Yes, that's what they're saying, as early as next week, and they've got some possible names. Tim Geithner, we know, probably is going on January, and the leading candidate is Jack Lew, the chief of staff, who's also a former budget director.
Mm-hmm.
So he's the most likely one there. So then we need a chief of staff. So there are various possibilities there. That the former chief of staff to Biden, Thomas Nides, I think that's how you pronounce it, who's a former COO of Morgan Stanley.
Oy.
And also Tom Daschle, former Senate Majority Leader.
That's interesting.
That
would be interesting.
Yeah.
All right. You know, what I'm worried about is you show that, John Kerry is a leading candidate for Secretary of Defense when Leon Panetta leaves, if Susan Rice goes to state. Either way, they're really talking about John Kerry either being, made Secretary of Defense or Secretary of State, which opens a seat in Massachusetts, which would just leave an opening for Scott Brown to come back in.
And they're also talking, President Obama and Michelle had dinner with Governor Deval Patrick and his wife very recently to discuss an array of options for him over dinner.
That would be interesting. So, now, is Bill Richardson sort of not, because I thought he would make a good Secretary of State, but is it that he was a Hillary Clinton supporter? I don't know. He sort of disappeared lately.
he's got a woman problem.
Oh, does he?
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. Yeah. That's too bad.
Yeah.
All right. Yeah. All right. And there's more, but I know we're just about out of time. The one other thing I do want to ask about the post office. You have, with 6 weeks left in Congress, lawmakers are scrambling to finish legislation overhauling how the struggling U.S. Postal Service operates. But again, the only reason they're struggling is because a Republican lame duck Congress mandated passed legislation that says they've got to fund their pension and health care plans for 75 years within a 2-year period. Is there any chance that's going to be overturned? I mean, that they can fix it without putting the post office out of business?
I don't know. And as I was typing this morning, I thought that you were the host who was going to jump on this story.
Yeah.
I don't know whether they're even going to be able to. They think Elijah Cummings thinks there's a 50-50 chance that they're going to be able to address this at all during the lame duck session.
Wow. Well, you know what? Wait until the lame duck is over, because we've got more of a Democratic, more Democrats, more progressives in the House and certainly in the Senate, in the 113th Congress. So do they have to do it by the end of this year?
No, they don't have
to do good.
It by the end of
then
this
wait.
Year.
Don't deal with it in the lame duck. Deal with it in the next session.
Yeah, that is an option. But
then
they
maybe
they
can fix it.
They're just getting very jittery about it.
It's so sad what they've done to the post office. Because, again, the right-wing playbook is they want to privatize it. They basically want to shutter the U.S. Postal Service, which, by the way, is self-contained. They support themselves. They don't take taxpayer money. And they want to replace it with, like a FedEx. Hello.
Hello.
It's sick. All right. Victoria Jones from the Talk Radio News Service. Find her at talkradionews.com. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. We do have a busy, busy show. So, you know what? Let's take a quick break. We'll check in with Jim Hightower, and we'll come back on the other side with Joshua Hirsch. Joshua Hirsch writes for Huffington Post. He covers U.S. foreign policy and the world. And his latest piece is on the Israel-Gaza war. It's not a conflict, it's a war. And it's entitled Gaza Conflict Highlights Israel's Search for a Long-Term Strategy on Palestine. We'll get the latest from Joshua Hirsch next. Don't go away. I'm Nicole Sandler. It's Radio or Not.
Romney showed on election night why America is lucky that he lost. I'll tell you about it today on Hightower Radio. If for no other reason, President Obama's re-election was a victory in the sense that America averted a hard Romney-Ryan lurch rightward, downward, and backward all at once. Ouch, that would have hurt. By campaign's end, it was painfully clear that Romney, a lifelong son of privilege, had no understanding of, empathy with, or appreciation for ordinary workaday Americans. He really is a born CEO who accepts in his heart, mind, and soul the Ayn Randian fiction that America really is made up of a small class of noble producers and a mass of moochers. The man from Bain Capital, who had made a fortune by taking over corporations and coldly axing longtime loyal employees, quietly brought that corporate side of his character back into play on election night. Even as he was on national television delivering his brief concession speech, his campaign apparatus was being swiftly dismantled. Left in the lurch were Romney's many staffers who had toiled so faithfully for so long. Late that night, many of these disappointed and weary ones grabbed cabs home from the campaign's headquarters, only to find upon arrival that the Romney for President credit cards they had been using were suddenly no good. Without even telling these aides, the boss who wanted to be our nation's leader had abruptly yanked this modest benefit from the people who had tried to help him get there. They had just lost their jobs, but multimillionaire Mitt stuck them with paying out of pocket for cab fare. This is Jim Hightower saying, come on, with untold millions stashed in offshore bank accounts, couldn't Romney have ponied up a few small bills to cover this last ride home? Of course he could have. But he wouldn't. Of all things to think of doing on election night, cutting off his employees' credit cards was a priority. We're lucky this sorry character lost.
Need an antidote to the progressive blues? Want some good news about how grassroots folks are rebelling against the corporate powers and winning? Well, here's an easy-to-swallow pill for you, the Hightower Lowdown. Hightower's monthly newsletter will give you the lowdown, even as it lifts you up. It's 4 pages a month, jam-packed with facts you can use, actions you can take, and Jim's own Texas humor, all for only $15 a year. To become a lowdowner, go to HightowerLowdown.org.
What is the Boca Show?
I don't know what it is, but it's moving.
Sounds different than you would think. Britt Reed of the Daily Sentinel. Before getting the check, Larry King said,
"The worst talk radio I've ever heard in my life."
After getting the check, Larry King says,
"That is great radio."
The Boca Show, Sundays at 4 and 7 on 1470 WNN. Archive shows available at thebocashow.com and soflowradio.com. The Boca Show, for when you get bored.
Hi, friends. This is Tom Hartman.
This is Stephanie Miller.
Hey, this is Hal Sparks.
I'm Brad Friedman. I approve of Nicole Sandler's RadioOrNot.com.
Radio or not.
Radio or not.
RadioOrNot.com.
Radio or not.com.
RadioOrNot.com.
Radio or not.com.
All right. Nicole Sandler back with you at the aforementioned RadioOrNot.com. On Friday, I was called in at the last minute to guest host the Randy Rhoads Show. She was out sick. And I read to you, if you were listening, a piece written by Uri Avnery. He is a member of the Israeli Knesset back like from 1963 to 16, two stints in the Knesset. He was in Israel at the founding of Israel. He's been there from the beginning. He is an Israeli Jew who then went on to found the Israeli peace movement called Gush Shalom. I'm not going to read it here. I will post it again today on my blog at RadioOrNot.com. So if you missed it, you can read it. It's really important. Let me say again, up front, I believe there is no right and no wrong here. Well, they're both wrong. Will from Chicago says it would be great if you can get Uri on this show or Randy's show. The problem is, and I'll try calling him again. I tried him on Thursday, and we did get him, but he asked me to call back later, and I haven't been able to reconnect with him. He's very old. And he's got a very thick accent, and the connection between here and Tel Aviv, where he lives, the time difference is not a problem because right now it's like 7 o'clock there at night. It's not for Randy's show. It's a problem for this show. It's not, but it's hard to understand him. But I will try. I'll try to get him on again. But the bottom line is, he says we need peace. These rockets being launched, the people being killed, that is not the answer. Let's get Joshua Hirsch on the line. He covers foreign affairs for Huffington Post. He joined me. Hey, Joshua, it's Nicole Sandler calling.
Hi, how are you?
I'm great. How are you doing?
Great.
Good. I wanted to talk with you again. Joshua Hirsch covers foreign policy, foreign affairs for the Huffington Post. And I wanted to, get your take on what's going on in the Middle East. Obviously, as I just said, I think there's no right. Nobody's right. I think both sides are wrong here. Lobbing rockets across the border is not going to fix anything. It's just killing people.
Right.
A lot
right.
of people, mostly in Gaza, are being killed right now. What is the latest that you have?
Well, the latest is that this sort of air assault from Israel and the sort of responding rocket fire, which has dwindled a bit in the last 24 hours, is basically ongoing. It's just kind of continuing drip, drip, drip kind of thing. And I think today there's a little more attention turned towards whether there can be a negotiated diplomatic solution to this. And that's what everyone's kind of keeping an eye on. The Israelis just put out, I think, through the BBC and some other places, a series of ideas about what sort of things they'd expect from a ceasefire. They're pretty strict. They're pretty tough. A lot of people looking at them sort of think on the face that it will be tough for Hamas to meet them, including one of which is a sort of guarantee that all rocket fire will stop from Gaza, and not all rocket fire comes from Hamas. So that's part of the problem.
Right. Now, so, do the Palestinians have any say in this matter? Because I look at how they are shoved into this very small area known as the Gaza Strip.
Right.
And as somebody, Chris Hayes on Up With Chris did a great segment on it. And yes. A woman, and I don't remember her name, but she was excellent. And she basically said, look, Gaza, it's an open-air prison. And that's what it is. These people don't have enough to eat. There's this blockade, so supplies can't get to them. They are in an open-air prison. It's hell on earth.
I think that's important to remember. You know, I mean, obviously you get in a lot of you get very quickly into tricky situations when you, like you said, try to decide who's right and who's wrong.
Right.
I've spent time in Sderot, which is a town outside of Gaza that gets hit with a particularly high frequency of these rockets that come. They're very inaccurate, that Hamas fires. They just kind of flail about. I mean, you know, one statistic that I think is important, before this latest, you know, inflagration started up, Hamas and other militant groups had fired something like 600 rockets at Israel, and resulted in zero deaths. And that's sort of an indication of kind of how chaotic it is. But it's scary. It's terrifying to live there, and you're constantly worried about a rocket coming in. And so I've been there, and I've also been to Gaza, and I think that, you know, they live in constant fear of drones flying overhead, which do all the time, and the Israeli Navy off the shore shooting, which it does pretty much every day, and airstrikes, which happen relatively often, I mean, throughout all this. You know, you don't hear a lot about it, but it happens on a somewhat semi-daily basis. And like you said, you know, one of the key differences is that if you're in Sderot, I know this is cold comfort for people, but if you're in Sderot and you feel like you need to get out of there, you can. You can go to the north. If you're in Gaza and you feel like you need to get out of there, there's nowhere to go. You're not able to leave.
Right.
That's an important distinction.
Right. Now, since the election in Egypt and the new president, who's a member of the Muslim Brotherhood, there is a border between Gaza and Egypt. And I know, have they opened that at all? Is there any recourse for the Palestinians who are imprisoned in Gaza to get supplies or get escape through Egypt?
There is. It's so incredibly complicated, Nicole. And, you know, I mean, part of the problem is that, and a lot of people, I think, expected that after the Muslim Brotherhood took the presidency after Morsi took over, and essentially after Mubarak's sort of intelligence regime broke down at least a little bit, that you'd see a changed relationship with Gaza, and in particular that border would fly open.
Right.
You know, Egypt had a lot of reasons to keep a clampdown on that border. It has changed a little bit. I mean, the tunnels, for one thing, depend a little bit on Egypt looking the other way, and that's increased in the last couple of years. There's no question. And I mean, not the tunnels for missiles so much as the tunnels for basic
supplies.
Food
stuff.
A lot of the food stuff that comes into Gaza comes in through those tunnels.
Wow.
Actually, that's the only way. But so that stuff has increased, and the border isn't completely shut down like it was in 2008, 2009. Mm-hmm. You could not get in. A journalist couldn't get in, and as of yesterday, even journalists were still kind of flowing in through that border, which is a big difference. Egypt has a couple incentives. One is to maintain its essential Camp David Accord with Israel, which means keeping some security lockdown there and in the Sinai. And they also don't want to end up being responsible for Gaza. And this is something that people talk about a lot. They'd like to see, I think on the Israeli side, they'd love to see that this conflict results in Egypt kind of absorbing Gaza in some either literal or philosophical way. And Egypt really doesn't want to do that.
Sure.
You know, for maybe obvious reasons.
Well, they've got their own problems.
Sorry, yeah.
Yeah, they do. We're speaking with Joshua Hirsch of Huffington Post. Your latest piece is Gaza Conflict Highlights Israel's Search for a Long-Term Strategy on Palestine, and I've got a link on my blog at radioornot.com. But you do give a little bit of the background of this latest round of fighting, and again, the role that Israel's assassination of Ahmed Jabari played in it.
Yes.
Now, I had read a piece in Haaretz, the Israeli newspaper, that said that Jabari was working with one of the peace activists who you talk about, Gershon Baskin, in Israel.
Yeah.
And that there was some sort of like a truce agreement that Jabari had gotten, and Israel's leadership was aware of it, and they went ahead and killed him anyway. And then somebody told me that had been debunked. Was that debunked?
I think that... I don't know if debunked is the right word. I never was able to kind of, to my comfort, confirm that.
Okay.
You know, I think that it was part of kind of back channel conversations that always go on. But the broader point that I think is important that Gershon Baskin made to me and made in an op-ed in the Times and other places is that this guy, Ahmed Jabari, for all of his evils, and there are plenty of them, he is actually in a lot of ways a pragmatic figure, and you could talk to him. He was someone you could have a conversation with. You know, Israel right now wants, as part of their conditions of a ceasefire, the ceasage of all rockets flying out of the Gaza Strip. Well, there are a lot of groups with rockets in the Gaza Strip, and Jabari was a figure who was actually, if he wanted to, actually able to impose that ceasefire to make sure that Islamic Jihad and other groups don't fire rockets. Now that guy's gone.
And who knows who he's going to be replaced with. It could be somebody a lot more...
Definitely will be, to be honest, at least in the short term. And so is there somebody who you can turn to who can guarantee to Israel's satisfaction that there will be no more rockets? Well, you killed that guy. There might be others, but now he's gone.
Below your piece, this piece at Huffington Post, there's a live blog, and one is Al Jazeera has footage of the explosion at the Shirouk Media Building, and I'm following the IDF Twitter feed, which is, boy, it's Israeli propaganda at its best. Not to say that there isn't an equal, propaganda feed coming from Hamas. Again, both sides are reprehensible in this, I think. But Israel targeted this media building, and the IDF Twitter feed said, well, we made sure just to target the second floor where there were operatives. And, again, come on. So what is the lay? I mean, there's just a lot of bombing going on where people just aren't safe.
I think that, I mean, look, you know, one of the things that happened in the first few days of these airstrikes is they, and this was told me by an Israeli colonel, a retired colonel who spent a lot of time in Gaza as a commander. And one of the things that happened is they more or less exhausted the targets that they had that were out in open areas. And now they have to move in towards targets that are closer. This is why inevitably the talk of a ground war comes in, because if you want to kill a guy on the second floor of a building, the best way to do it is send in troops, right, as opposed to dropping a bomb on it. And that's kind of why they talk about that. But yeah, you know, I have sort of the same reaction to you as about the sort of propaganda, and it's hard to know why necessarily, because of course the Qassam brigades put out their own propaganda in English, and it's a lot of the same posturing and nonsense. But you wonder, you wonder if maybe you find yourself holding the Israelis to a higher standard for some reason. Maybe we do. Maybe it's because they have such precision weapons, you know, and so if they're shooting them at a building and they know there are journalists there, and journalists get killed, well, maybe they're more responsible for that.
Maybe. I don't know either. You know, and then there's another piece here that says majority of Americans back Israel in Gaza conflict. CNN.com is reporting that a majority of Americans say that Israel's current military strikes against Gaza are justified, according to a new national survey. It indicates 57% of the public says Israel is justified in taking military action in Gaza against Hamas, with 1 in 4 saying the attacks are unjustified. Is this just because our media is so one-sided and we're not hearing about the fact that Gaza is an open-air prison and what's the conditions that the Palestinians are forced to live in?
I think maybe a little bit. I if you listen to Israelis on Twitter and elsewhere, I mean, and pro-Israeli folks here, they think our media is utterly biased against them.
Wow.
So everyone feels that way about their own position in this particular conflict. But I also think the tone is set by our political leaders. I mean, with the exception of Keith Ellison, who I spoke to on Friday and offered he's a representative from Minnesota and offered a voice of dissent here. The exception of him, there's been no voices from the White House or from Congress saying.
No.
Even with any sincerity and thrust that you know, we got to be careful about civilian casualties in Gaza. I mean, there's basically nothing about that. So that sets a tone that says, you know, this is righteous and it's, you know, it's appropriate.
It's so sad because, again, the latest numbers that I have, at least 91 people in Gaza are now dead, including many children, 700 wounded, including 200 children. Three Israelis have been killed and 79 wounded. And again, with Israel, you've got like one of the most mighty military, militaries of any country behind the U.S. Against, you know, the people in Gaza who have, you know, like makeshift weapons and are throwing rocks and these.
I mean, you can't hide from those numbers. I think those numbers are incredibly important. And every time you see Michael Oren, who's the Israeli ambassador to the United States, or another figure go on, they don't talk about those numbers. The numbers they talk about is this idea of what they used to say 1.5 million or 3 million Israelis who live under fear of rockets. Now I think they say 5 million because a rocket reached Tel Aviv. Or got near Tel Aviv, so that's how they talk about it. But what they don't like to say is how many have been actually killed by those rockets. And again, it's not to diminish the horror of living in
no.
that situation, but that if you feel that way about the situation in Israel, then you have to, I think, if you have integrity about it, feel that way about the situation in Gaza.
Exactly.
And the numbers are vastly disproportionate. They just are.
Exactly. And look, as an American Jew, it sickens me. I want them to be right. Now, how much does the upcoming election in Israel have to do with all of this?
You know, I wish I knew more about the inner workings of Israeli mm-hmm. politics. They're pretty complicated.
Yeah.
My understanding is that, you know, in some ways it's similar to our dynamic. Labor, the Israeli kind of leftist or left-leaning party, was making some inroads politically by talking about the economy, and returning focus to foreign policy and common enemies, that sort of thing. It's always an effective tactic. There was a poll in Haaretz did on Sunday that showed that Benjamin Netanyahu, the prime minister of Israel, his popularity soared 20 points in the last couple of days, and is as high as it's been since Gilad Shalit was released a year ago.
Yeah.
So, in that sense, it's sort of normal. Whether that is the pure impetus for this or not, I mean, it depends on kind of how cynical you are, I guess.
And again, I try to be pragmatic about it all and realize that,
right.
you know, both sides have a point here, but the way to fix it is not to lob bombs at one another.
Well, that's the question. That's what I wrote about yesterday, is this question of if everyone in Israel acknowledges that this, like 2009 cast lead, is a short-term solution. So the fact that we've returned to it again, I think, points to the fact that there really hasn't been any progress in a long-term solution. No one thinks that this is a long-term solution. So what are we going to do? Do this again in 4 years? I think that becomes an issue.
Yeah, well, hopefully something will be fixed between now and then. But again, the sad thing is they assassinated the guy who was sort of the leader there that people could talk to, the one who
right.
was
no,
at least...
Not, let's not make him out to be a lovely
right.
man.
I no, mean, he's an evil
but,
man.
But, you know,
but again,
practicalities matter in that
right.
region.
But again, as you point out, he at least was talking with this Israeli peace activist. What's his name? Gershon Baskin.
And Gershon, you know, is not just a totally random fellow, because he, for your listeners' benefit, I mean, he's one of the guys who played a sort of instrumental role behind the scenes in negotiating the release of Gilad Shalit.
Right.
So that you know, there's some legitimacy to that.
Exactly. And as the listeners here know, I'm a longtime reader and appreciator of the work done by Uri Avnery, who founded Gush Shalom, the big peace movement in Israel, who is basically saying the same things. I don't know if you see his writings or not, but
no, I hadn't actually.
You know what? I'm going to send you. I'll email you his latest column, because it's really important stuff. I mean, the guy he makes so much sense, and basically he's saying, you know, we got to stop this now. So it's just sad. And as much as I'd like to say, well, hopefully things will get better in coming days, I have no reason to think that it will.
Yeah. One big difference between now and 2008, 2009 is the amount of journalism going on. And some of it is because there are international journalists from major outlets there, and there just were not back then. You know, there was Ayman Mohyuddin, who was with Al Jazeera English. Now he's with NBC. He was there then. That's it, though.
Uh-huh.
Then. And now you've got a dozen or more major publications have their correspondents there, and Twitter and social media means that we know much, much more about what's going on in Gaza than we did back then. And I think that makes a huge difference.
You're right. So at least, yes, there are people on the ground. And there are people in Gaza who are getting, you know, having to, as I said, this report from CNN. And the reporter said, I got to go because mortar's coming in. So I'll talk to you later. Bye.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you so much, Joshua Hirsch.
I
always appreciate your input, and we'll talk again, I'm sure.
I hope so.
Okay, thank you. Bye-bye. All right, so that's what's happening there. We're just going to move on and get Jason Leopold on the line, because there's another big story here closer to home. It is, Jazz Cat Trio even says, so incredibly sad.
Yeah, I'm gonna send him the statement from Uri Avnery. It is posted on my blog at radioornot.com from the 15th. So I think my latest blog entry, it's up there. And yeah, I mean, here's a little bit of what he wrote. He said, let's see. The name chosen for the new war in Gaza is Operation Cloud Pillar. A far more appropriate name would have been Operation Short Memory. This is former Knesset member Uri Avnery, Gush Shalom activist. Prime Minister Netanyahu is counting. Oh, this is a statement of Gush Shalom on this. Prime Minister Netanyahu is counting on the public's short memory. Netanyahu counts upon people forgetting that dozens and dozens and even hundreds of, quote, liquidations had been carried out, excuse me, and they did not solve any problem. Always, there was somebody replacing those who were killed, and more than once, the new one was more capable and more radical. Netanyahu counts on people not remembering that 4 years ago, Israel went to war in Gaza, killing 1,300 civilians in 3 weeks, which otherwise did not make any significant change in the situation. Netanyahu counts on people failing to remember that just yesterday morning, the media reported on people in the communities of the South heaving a sigh of relief at the complete cessation of missiles from Gaza. Benjamin Netanyahu and Ehud Barak have taken the decision for the second time in a row, the state of Israel will conduct general elections under the shadow of war in the Gaza Strip. The ceasefire, which already started to stabilize, had been broken and shattered to pieces. The inhabitants of the communities of southern Israel who just started to breathe freely are sent right back to air raid alarms and running to shelters. At the price of great suffering on both sides of the border, the government's aim had been accomplished. The social issues, which threatened to assume prominence in these elections, have been pushed aside and removed from the agenda of the elections campaign. Forgotten, too, is the brave attempt of Mahmoud Abbas to address the Israeli public opinion. In the coming weeks, the headlines will be filled with constant war and death, destruction and bloodshed. When it ends at last, it will be revealed that no goal has been achieved and that the problems remain the same or perhaps got worse. It's so sad. I know it's a bit of a segue here, but let me get Jason Leopold on the line. Jason Leopold, of course, writes great investigative pieces over at truthout.org. Hopefully Jason's home. And his latest piece is entitled BP Will Kill Again, Former EPA Officials and Attorney Warn. Yeah. Jason Leopold.
How's it going, Nicole?
Okay. How are you doing?
Great.
Good. All right. We're live on the air. So you've got another great piece up at truthout.org about BP. It's been a little while since you've written about BP, but the occasion is this record $4.5 billion fine levied against BP just the other day and criminal indictments of three people. But
two of them for manslaughter related to the spill.
Okay, but what they should get, because 11 people were killed in that, and I hate to call it a spill. It was an explosion, and it was a nightmare, is a good way to put it. The spewage, this underwater volcano of oil that went on seemingly forever. But 11 people were killed, and it was criminally negligent homicide in my book, not manslaughter. And your headline is that former EPA officials and attorney warned BP will kill again. This $4.5 billion fine, which may seem like a lot to you and me, is really a drop in the bucket for them, isn't it?
Exactly. Well, it's not even the fact of the fine is sort of, their position is who cares about the fine? What they really want to see is BP's top executives, top officials, who basically passed down the word that these decisions and cost-cutting measures should be should be implemented. They should be hauled off, to prison, or rather be indicted and prosecuted and held responsible for the for the death of 11 rig workers. And what they're also trying to say is, and you and I have spoken about this, Nicole, because I've covered BP extensively after the spill.
Yep.
BP always pays fines. In fact, they hold many, many records for having the largest fine. OSHA, the Occupational Safety and Health Administration, just before, a few months before the Gulf disaster, they fined BP. It was a record fine, $88 million, for what they said were, for what OSHA said was 760, more than 760 willful and egregious safety violations at their refineries. So, when you see that number, $4.5 billion, it doesn't mean anything, at least to the people I've spoken with. And moreover, it's just a drop in the bucket for BP when you consider what they earn in terms of a profit.
Right, exactly. It is. It's nothing. Now, the indictment of these three employees, this is not Tony Hayward, Mr. I Want My Life Back, right?
I'm sorry?
I said this is not Mr. I Want My Life Back, Tony Hayward.
This is not. And, it remains to be seen if, in fact, the government will use these three to try and go after bigger fish. I think that many people will doubt it. I sort of doubt it simply because of what we've seen or how we've seen this, Justice Department work when it comes to accountability. And it seems that they refuse to hold any of the real top officials accountable. This, to me, almost, the indictment of these two rig workers, both men in their 60s, and the low-level BP official, what they call him a senior executive, or he was a senior executive at the time, it sort of reminds me of Abu Ghraib, when the low-hanging fruit was prosecuted for the torture that took place there. But the individuals in the Bush administration who had handed down these orders, walked free. And that's what they're, what the people I've spoken with have tried to say about BP. There's no level of independent thinking there. So the two rig workers who, may be responsible, for who may be negligent, there's just no way that they acted on their own. They must have received orders, from the very top.
Right. Right. In fact, you've written, again, if you go back to do a Google search or a Truth Out search for Jason Leopold and BP, we'll see a lot of stories on, what happened, what led up to the Deepwater Horizon explosion. And we learned about the cost cutting.
That's huge. I mean, in fact, and thanks, Nicole, for mentioning that. At the bottom of my story, I've actually... there's a long list of, the reports that I put together from 2010. But Lanny Brewer, the, Assistant Attorney General, said at this news conference last week, where they, where the government announced that, they entered into a settlement, they reached a settlement with BP to resolve all, most of the criminal charges, the civil ones are still hanging out there. But he said that, this was a culture, Lanny Brewer saying this is a culture at BP, that where profits were put before safety, and that is the culture that exists at BP, and it's what ultimately led to the Deepwater Horizon disaster. And so for people who have investigated BP and have seen this time and again, those words really the punishment means nothing, because
right.
Who's being held responsible?
Well,
you
nobody.
Two rig workers who are in their 60s. One of the, one guy, he was on the drilling rig for 4 days.
Oh God!
Previously,
wow.
So, it's just not good enough.
And then this part that just stuck out. Let me read to you a couple of paragraphs here. You wrote. In the months following the disaster in the Gulf, BP was found to have violated a federal judge's March 2009 felony judgment, which required BP to fulfill the terms of a settlement agreement it entered into with the government regulators to make certain safety upgrades at its Texas City refinery, make sure they were made by September 2009. Now, instead of revoking the company's probation and holding senior officials accountable for continuing to flout the law, DOJ authorized BP to spend an additional 2 years correcting hundreds of safety problems that have plagued the refinery, the third largest in the country, for a decade and played a part in the deaths of 19 people since 2009. So instead of like making, when they do something wrong, instead of holding them accountable and shutting them down, now the same thing happened again once the Deepwater Horizon exploded. They didn't stop them, and now it's 2 years later, and the and all the, you know, and now they can't, you know, they can't get at the right people, or they're not willing to get at the right people. And part of it, you're right, and some of the people that you interviewed allege that it's because maybe it's because because the government gets too much of its oil from BP.
Well, there's no question that we do. I mean, the Pentagon relies heavily on BP. In fact, it's a very lengthy story, as you know, most of my stories are articles. Yes. So, you know, down below in the middle or three quarters of the way through, I talk about the government contracts. And I, you know, hyperlinked or attached a link where, you know, the public, the readers can go see exactly what, you know, what we're spending, where our taxpayer dollars are going in terms of, you know, the government contracts for BP. And, you know, BP is one of the top 100 contractors that the government, you know, that receives government contracts.
Right, right.
And they receive, and the Pentagon, you know, relies heavily on them for fuel just this past September, 2 months ago, while the Justice Department was negotiating with BP on this very settlement. BP received a fuel contract from the Pentagon, two of them, that has a maximum, it's worth about $1.3 billion, you know, over the course of 5 years. That's the maximum value of that contract. Anyone will tell you that, you know, when you get a maximum value, you can be sure that the company is going to maximize that to receive all of the money.
Right.
You know, last year, BP received, I think, about $1.4 billion in federal contracts. So, just in 2 years, they've already generated about half the income that they would need to pay off this, you know, this debt.
Right. Now, and that's just from the government contracts.
But, just from the government contract.
By the way, I found the other part where you're right. You know, the project on government oversight, POGO, says that BP has racked up more instances of misconduct, 61 since 1995, than any of the other top 100 corporations that receive government contracts, right? POGO's general counsel told you that BP should have faced debarment or suspension immediately after oil started to spew into the Gulf.
Right.
But,
exactly,
he said, it appears that the government took a wait-and-see approach to how this case was settled. At that point, nearly 3 years have passed. BP fired some executives and hired new engineers and compliance monitors. They aren't environmentally compliant, but they are performing well under their government contracts. So it just makes it impossible to hold the company accountable for something that took place in the past. Then he said there's also the question about whether they may be too big to suspend or debar because the government is so reliant on BP for fuel.
Right, exactly. And, you know, and his point is that, you know, this is something that should have been done right after the disaster,
right,
you know, in the Gulf.
But they didn't.
And in fact, the woman, you know, Jean Pascal, who I spoke to, and I've spoken to her in the past as well, and she was the debarment counsel at the EPA. She prepared a complaint in which she told me 60 exhibits to have BP debarred.
Now, debarred means
from government contract.
Okay, there you go.
And, however, she retired from, this was in 2010, she retired from the EPA, and her recommendations to, you know, to suspend BP went nowhere.
Wow.
So, you know, this is, you know, what we're seeing right now, is great sort of window dressing in a sense, and it looks good. You know, they put on it's almost theatrical. Last week, Eric Holder and many Justice Department officials were in New Orleans. This big announcement. But ultimately, what people want to see is that they want to see that the CEOs, the ones that are really making this decision, the board members, that they're not above the law. You know, that if they're implementing a policy that trickles down to a rig worker and the rig worker does it, that, you know, that those at the top are actually held accountable. I mean, it's remarkable because I actually think if the disaster at Enron or the implosion happened today, it would be unlikely we would see, you know, Jeff Skilling or Ken Lay, the late Ken Lay,
right.
You know, being
well,
hauled off to prison.
If you believe Ken Lay is dead.
Right, exactly.
I think he's just gone living on an island somewhere.
Yeah, yeah. So, again, I want to point out that there are billions and billions of dollars, tens of billions of dollars, that BP still needs to, in civil penalties, that they'll likely have to pay, although BP is stating that they will fight that,
and
any remaining civil penalties.
Right. Well, you write this, despite the most recent guilty pleas and indictments, Pascal, the woman you were talking about, who was an EPA, what was her position, an EPA attorney?
She was the person at the EPA,
right,
that basically handled contracts and recommended whether the company should be suspended or,
right,
debarred.
Okay, and you write that Pascal will always think of BP as being, quote, beyond prosecution. Until their top executives responsible for the decisions underlings make all spend time in jail. And,
right.
And that's the thing. I mean, you look at these three guys who were held accountable, who were indicted the other day, and I got to say, they're scapegoats.
Well, you know, it's Scott West, who is, again, a former EPA criminal. He's a former special agent at the EPA is in their criminal investigation division, and he's in the story, and he said, look, you know, the two guys on the rig that they indicted, they lived on the rig. They didn't want to burn up and die.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they didn't want, you know, they made a decision, and it obviously remains to be seen whether a jury will buy into what the government's arguing, but they didn't want to die, and they certainly wouldn't have, and at least this is Scott's opinion, made such a decision to save BP a dollar, you know, putting their own lives on line. So he believes that this was, you know, something that came down via memo or some sort of, you know, cost-cutting measure policy, but instead of, you know, or at least hold the guys at the top responsible as well, as opposed to, or in addition to just, you know, hauling these folks in.
So you quote a man named Brent Kuhn. He's an attorney based in Beaumont, Texas, who sued BP on behalf of victims and families of those killed in that Texas City refinery blast. And he says it's just a matter of time before BP kills again. Now, just this Friday, we saw another oil platform in the Gulf explode. Where they found the body of one of the two missing platform workers. From what I can tell, is a smaller company, although on Friday their website was down, so we couldn't even get information about that. Is the problem that, you know, that we don't have good enough standards on these oil rigs or that we don't enforce them? What's the deal?
Yeah, no, that's a great question. And, you know, the issue basically comes to, it's a matter of enforcement. You know, the regulations are there, but the government regulators are not enforcing these regulations. So this is actually an issue that Scott Amy over at Pogo, you know, had mentioned to me. He said, look, you know, this, you know, what's happening with BP is likely a matter of, you know, enforcement. We need the government to enforce these regulations that exist and that ensure that these companies follow it. I'm sure you recall, Nicole, that, you know, after the in the aftermath of the Deepwater Horizon explosion, we started to see these reports come out about, at the time, what it was called, Minerals Management Service, and how close they were. You know, this is from the Interior Department, how close these officials were to the oil companies, to the point, literally, where you had agents, investigators sleeping with the officials over at the, you know, the oil companies, and, you know, participating in drug use with them. I mean,
yep.
This is literally a report that is out there. So a company like BP, or even, let's say, Shell, Chevron, any of the of the major oil producers are, you know, not abiding by the law, flouting the law. Well, it's, again, it comes down to, you know, the regulations do exist. Certainly they can be stronger, but what is it, does that really matter if the ones that are already in place are not being enforced?
No.
Probably not.
No, not at all. In fact, we're out of time here, Jason Leopold, but I'm going to keep you on for just another minute or two on our Ustream channel and on Talk Radio 1 to answer a question that Panora just asked in the chat room, because it's all related. Panora asks also, does the Exxon disaster in Alaska, I don't know how many years ago, set any precedent for this? You want to talk about how this is all tied together?
Well, certainly, that was 1989, the Valdez.
That's right.
I mean, you know, you had the head of the, you know, the Valdez, the ship's captain, was basically fell asleep. I think he was drunk. But it underscored how these companies were unprepared. So when you have a spill, for lack of a better word, you know, basically, for at least in the Gulf, this was hemorrhaging. There was no preparation, no policy in place that from the company or from the government on how to prepare and to react to to such a spill. So we've seen these disasters in years past, but what have we learned from them? Well, our response time is that's the problem there. I know it's a very long-winded answer, we seem to have learned, but not actually enforced these oil companies to come up with a plan for how they will respond to spills such as this or disasters, and that's what we saw with BP. So we should have learned, but we did not.
No, and
or
what
I should
else?
Say that the company should have learned. And
the DOJ should have learned, and this nation, when nothing was done following the Exxon Valdez, following BP's Texas oil refinery, following the Deepwater Horizon, and thankfully, the Atlantis platform hasn't. There's been no disaster there as of yet. But you, Jason Leopold, again, you've written extensively on this. We've talked about it on this show, and it's another disaster waiting to happen. And to the best of my knowledge, and you could talk more to it. Have they done anything to fix things there so that we won't have a catastrophe there?
Well, you know, this. After what happened in the Gulf, after somehow the government successfully controlled the narrative and it went away and people forgot about it, there was the issues pertaining to the Atlantis platform or the Atlantis rig was still unfolding in federal court. And ultimately, you know, the whistleblower, what he had claimed what was happening with regard to safety, was simply just sort of dismissed by a federal court judge, more or less. But it's actually still winding its way through the courts, but it doesn't appear that BP actually undertook any sort of action to, you know, to address the safety shortcomings.
Amazing.
And, just one last thing is that, you know, they settled with the government, you know, in Texas City. They settled with the government in Alaska. And as I note in my story, and yet when the government went back to Texas City to inspect the refinery and say, okay, you know, well, you pled guilty to a felony. Let's see how you did here. Did you make these safety upgrades? And well, they found out that they didn't. So what do? They give them, the government gives them another 2 years to do it. So this was actually a violation of their probation. And in Alaska, they promised to implement safety measures that would offset any sort of potential for, you know, oil leak up there. And, you know, they promised to do that, but they didn't. So, you know, here we have another promise. We will make sure this won't happen again. And the question is that why should anyone believe this company now?
Good
would
question.
You believe a person?
Right.
You
no.
know, so,
no.
And if corporations are people, well, you know, why would you believe them?
Yeah, and if corporations are people, this one deserves the death penalty. Jason Leopold, once again, great reporting on this. I've got a link on my blog at RadioOrNot.com to this latest story, and if you scroll down to the end, there's links to lots of other related stories that you need to check out. Thank you so much, Jason.
Thank you, Nicole. I appreciate it.
I'll talk to you later. Always
take
great
care.
Work. Bye-bye. All right, and just to reiterate as we close the show, Alan West still lost. Yeah, we'll get back to that again tomorrow. It is history repeating itself. We'll talk to you tomorrow right here, Radio or Not. Bye, everyone.
That it's all just a little bit of history repeating.